Hi, I'm Waylon from Rain Depot. Today we're going to talk about one of the most foundational components of a reef aquarium, live rock. When reef keeping first began, traditional saltwater aquarists were confused by the term live rock. How could rock be living? But once they saw a reef aquarium where the rocks were bursting with marine life like corals, encrusting algae, and sponges, it was clear that reef rock played a key role in reef tanks. At first, we thought rock was just a structure to place corals and a space for shrimp and crabs to explore. But over the years, aquarists and marine biologists found that most of the life associated with reef rock was microscopic. The rough surface of live rock and the microscopic pores created by reef-boring algae and fungi are home to an invisible jungle of marine microorganisms that work behind the scenes to maintain the reef ecosystem. A recent discovery showed that coral and algae are the preferred landing spot for coral larvae. That's not new. But what is new is that certain corals prefer specific species of coral and algae. But there's more. Each species of coral and algae has its own unique bacterial biofilm. The bacteria releases a chemical called TBP. The coral senses the chemical and knows if it's the right algae to settle on. The coral will only attach to the rock if they receive the proper signal about the coral and algae. For reef aquarists, live rock provides a solid surface for the formation of biofilms. Biofilms are communities of cells stuck together by a polymer slime. The polymer provides protection against UV exposure, changes in salinity, natural antimicrobial compounds, and predation. The biofilm is not a single layer. A mature reef tank has layer upon layer of living biofilm on the rock. Nitrifying bacteria convert ammonia to nitrite, and then from nitrite to nitrate. Denitrifying bacteria will remove the nitrate by converting nitrate to nitrogen gas. Other microbes work to recycle a variety of nutrients and organic matter. A teaspoon of seawater contains about 5 million bacterial cells. Lab studies reveal that there are up to 400 times more bacteria growing on a solid surface than in seawater. And then there's algae, fungi, and protozoans that live on top of the biofilm. Live rock is home base for this microscopic zoo. You can see that much of the biological filtration in the reef aquarium takes place on the rock. Live rock also provides ledges and crevices to place corals and develop a lifelike reef aquarium. All natural reef rock harvested from the ocean. Before Fiji rock was banned from export, Fiji rock was the most common type of live rock. It was relatively lightweight and easy to handle. Fiji rock is usually boat shipped, which can take up to 30 days to arrive at the supplier's warehouse or fish store. Much of the marine life on the rock will not survive that long journey. Air shipments are possible for this live rock, but very expensive. Tonga branch is a denser, heavier rock. The antler-like shape adds an interesting dimension to the layout, and it's best used as accent pieces. Pukani rock is from Fiji, but it's lighter and quite porous. It's available in larger pieces, and is usually stacked to create stable shelves for corals. Man-made rock harvested from the ocean. Aquaculture live rock starts as either pieces of calcium rock or man-made rubble. It is scattered in the ocean and left for several years. Over that time, the rock becomes colonized with marine life and looks like natural live rock. Aquaculture live rock is sustainable and does not harm the reef ecosystem. It usually comes from the Gulf of Mexico or the Atlantic. That means if you live in North America, it arrives fresh and in good condition. All live rock must be inspected for decay and dead marine life. The farther it traveled, the greater chances it'll need to be cured. Here's why. Dead bacteria, sponges, worms, and algae start to decay during shipment. If you place the rock directly into your tank after shipment, chances are very good that the decaying marine life will release harmful ammonia, phosphate, and organics into your water. Curing live rock in dry live rock. Cure lightly if it's good live rock. Cure heavily if there are chances of pests or a lot of decay. If restarting a tank, heavily cure infested live rock. Use a soft brush to remove any dead surface material. Poke around in the crevices with a thin pick or a pencil to dislodge any crabs or worms or any other hitchhikers. The ideal curing method is to place a live rock in a plastic trash can or a tub filled with salt water. Heat the water to about 78 degrees Fahrenheit and add a submersible pump for water movement. If the rock has a lot of decaying material, it can take several weeks or even months until it's flushed from the rock. If the water smells bad or has high ammonia, you know it's going to take a while to cure. Some aquarists make a water change every week to remove the excess ammonia and decaying organics. If you choose to cure your rock in your aquarium, you will need to make a 100% water change after the cure is complete. And chances are, your water will be yellow and full of algae-promoting nutrients. Many aquarists will say they wish they cured the rock in a plastic tub instead of the aquarium, and that's our recommendation as well. There is a downside to starting a reef tank with live rock. No matter how careful you are with the curing process, undesirable hitchhiking marine life will find their way into your tank. Fireworms, bubble algae, and aptasia are common pests that sneak into the live rock. Another option is dry rock. This is dried live rock from the ocean. Even though it's completely dry, it still will leach nutrients and organics as the dead marine life on the rock decays in your water. It should be cured just like live rock. So check the water for ammonia and odors during the curing process. There are exceptions. AquaMaxx Dry Rock is an all-natural dried reef rock mined in the state of Florida. AquaMaxx rock needs no curing since it doesn't contain any living or dead organisms. All that's needed is a quick rinse and it's ready to use. Using mined rock like AquaMaxx or Caribsea South Sea based rock eliminates the curing process. It also prevents hitchhikers and gets your reef up and going very quickly. It will take time for the bare rock to become coated with coral and algae and biofilm, but over time, it will mature and look great in the aquarium. Caribsea's Life Rock is dried reef rock with a purple coating that looks like coral and algae. Over time, living coral and algae will cover the rock as the tank matures. Of all the questions we receive about reef rock, surface area seems to be the number one concern. Many aquarists get hung up about which rock is more porous or has the most surface area. They're worried there won't be enough surface area to support biological filtration. The truth is, reef aquariums have very low bioload compared to intensive aquaculture operations. Surface area can be limiting in fish grow-out systems, but not in our home aquariums. That's why we don't need wet-dry filters on reef aquariums. It's important to understand that the density of the microbial biofilter matches the amount of ammonia, nitrate, and organic nutrients produced in the tank. More surface area doesn't automatically mean a larger biological filter will form. No matter which rock you use, there will be more than enough surface area for nitrification, denitrification, and nutrient recycling. When the biofilm matures, it bursts, sending out microbes to start a new colony. This keeps the biofilter fresh and active at all times. In fact, biofilms have a life cycle. They don't stay in the same place on the rock. It's in a constant state of breaking apart and starting new biofilms. This brings up the next question. How much rock do I need? Well, the answer is not related to surface area. A lot depends on the design you're looking for. Some like a tank packed with shelves, others like a single pile of rock in the center of the tank. For the typical reef tank with rock piled along the back of the tank, we recommend about 1 pound per gallon. Extra rock can be broken up for rubble or placed in the refugium. If you're using dry rock, we recommend seeding the tank with pieces of rubble from another tank or refugium. You can also use a bacterial starter product. The best way to get coral and algae started is to scrape some from a piece of rock and disperse it into the new aquarium. And also, many coral frags have a coating of coral in that will also seed the rest of your aquarium. The key to working with live rock is patience. Part of the enjoyment of reef keeping is watching the transformation of a bare tank to a beautiful reef. If you have to cure the rock, allow for plenty of time to properly flush out the pores of decay. If you go with dry rock, take your time and allow the rock to become live slowly. Thank you for watching our video on live rock today. If you found this information helpful, please let us know by clicking the like button below. You can also subscribe to our channel for more upcoming educational content. Until next time, let's build a better aquarium together.